Let us now study about the Picard cartilage. It is the foundation stone of the larynx. That means it is the lowermost part of the larynx, lying at the level of C6. It consists of, if you see here, it is like this. This is the Picard cartilage. It is signet ring shaped, having an anterior arch. This one is the anterior arch, and this one is the posterior lamina. Is it clear? So it is resembling a signet ring. The dial is forming the posterior lamina, and the ring, this one, is forming the anterior arch. So it is having an anterior arch, and this one is the posterior lamina. Okay. Let us now study about the anterior arch first, and then followed by the posterior lamina. Okay. The anterior arch here, if you see, so this one is the Picard cartilage. This one is the anterior arch, and this is the posterior lamina. And this is cut part of thyroid cartilage. This thyroid cartilage, it is cut so that we can see what is happening inside. Under cover of this thyroid lamina, whatever is happening, you will come to know now. Okay. So this anterior arch consists of outer lip as well as inner lip. Is it clear? It consists of outer lip and inner lip. And this is arytenoid cartilage. This is cricoid cartilage, and this is cut part of thyroid lamina. Okay. This outer anterior arch consists of upper border, lower border, outer surface, and inner surface. Okay. Let us talk now about the upper border. This upper border consists of an outer lip as well as an inner lip. Outer lip gives origin to a muscle called lateral cricoarytenoidus muscle. It gives origin to a muscle called lateral. This is outer lip, which gives origin to a muscle called lateral cricoarytenoidus muscle. Okay, it is coming from the cricoid cartilage and inserting into the arytenoid cartilage from the lateral aspect, hence lateral cricoarytenoidus. Inner lip gives attachment to a fibroelastic cricovocal membrane. Inner lip gives attachment to a fibroelastic membrane called cricovocal membrane. Is it clear? And the thickened anterior part of this membrane is called conus elasticus, which already I have said to you. The thickened anterior part of that cricovocal membrane is called conus elasticus. Posteriorly, this cricovocal membrane blends with the fibrous capsule of cricoarytenoid joint. Cricovocal membrane anteriorly is thickened to form conus elasticus. Posteriorly, it blends with the fibrous capsule of the cricoarytenoid joint. Behind the joint lies the recurrent laryngeal nerve, and the outer lip gives origin to lateral cricoarytenoidus muscle. This is about the upper border. The lower border, if you see, it is continuous with the cartilaginous rings of trachea. It is continuous with the cartilaginous rings of trachea. Lower border by cricotracheal ligament. So junction between this trachea and this Picard cartilage is in the form of a ligament called This is cricotracheal ligament. This is about the lower border of the anterior arch of the cricoid cartilage. Now coming to the outer surface, already you know outer surface is this one. Outer surface gives origin to a muscle called cricothyroid muscle, the only extrinsic muscle of the larynx. And this cricothyroid muscle is having a straight fibers in front and an oblique fibers behind. The straight fibers are called pars of pars recta. The straight fibers are called pars recta, and these oblique fibers are called pars oblica. It is the only extrinsic muscle of the larynx being supplied by the external laryngeal nerve, and the main action is it is the chief tensor of vocal cords. The tension of the vocal cords is happening at the expense of this only one extrinsic muscle, and that is cricothyroid muscle. Is it clear? Origin from the outer surface of the anterior arch of cricoid cartilage, insertion to the lower border of the lamina of the corresponding side of the thyroid cartilage. Now supply is external laryngeal nerve. Action is tension of the vocal cords. So this is all about the anterior arch. And inner surface of the anterior arch is lined by the mucous membrane, lined with the respiratory epithelium, that is ciliated columnar epithelium. Okay. Now coming to the posterior arch. So now we are seeing like this from behind. So this is the view which was like this. Upper border, lower border, and this is a posterior lamina. Now the diagram is like this. I am just drawing this posterior arch, posterior lamina from behind. Okay. Now this is the posterior lamina. Okay, seen from behind. This posterior lamina, low, it has upper border, lower border, this is outer surface, and we have inner surface. So this lower border, to start with the lower border, it is continuous with the trachealis muscle. Lower border is continuous with the trachealis muscle. In front it is continuous with the cartilaginous rings of the trachea. Posteriorly the trachea does not have cartilage, and here it is replaced by a muscle, and this muscle is the trachealis muscle. Okay. It consists of a central depressed region here to which is attached the tendon of esophagus. This is a tendon of esophagus is attached. Here, which is nothing but the outer longitudinal fibers of the muscular layer of the esophagus, gets detached. Some fibers may get detached and is attached, may be attached to the center of the posterior arch, posterior lamina of the cricoid cartilage. This upper border articulates with the base of the corresponding arytenoid cartilage. Like this. So these are the two arytenoid cartilages. So this upper border presents a convex shoulders, two convex shoulders like this, which receives the articulation of the base of the corresponding sided arytenoid cartilage to form cricoarytenoid joints. To form, this is left and right, cricoarytenoid joints, a synovial type of joints permitting rotatory and gliding movements. The rest of this posterior surface of the posterior lamina gives origin to a muscle called posterior cricoarytenoidus muscle. So this is the posterior cricoarytenoidus muscle of left side. This is the posterior cricoarytenoidus muscle of right side. It is giving origin to this muscle called posterior cricoarytenoidus muscle, which is inserted onto the base of the corresponding sided arytenoid cartilage. This is arytenoid cartilage. Is it clear? So this is about the posterior surface of posterior lamina. The anterior surface of the posterior lamina is lined by the mucous membrane, forms the laryngeal cavity and lined by the ciliated columnar epithelium. So this is all about the cricoid cartilage. Coming to this arytenoid cartilages, these are plate cartilages having an apex, base, and each cartilage is having three surfaces. If you see the right sided cartilage, it has medial surface, anterolateral surface and posterior surface. Medial surface, anterolateral surface, posterior surface, apex, base. Base articulates with the posterior lamina of the cricoid cartilage to form cricoarytenoid joint. Okay. The anterolateral surface adjoining the apex is called vocal process, involves the vocal process. The anterolateral surface adjoining the apex is the vocal process. Okay. Now this arytenoid cartilages, it gives origin to a muscle from where the posterior cricoarytenoidous muscle ends. One more muscle arises, takes origin from there, and that is called as oblique arytenoidus. So this one is oblique arytenoidus. Base of one sided arytenoid cartilage is the origin. Insertion is the opposite sided apex of arytenoid cartilage. Similarly, this side like this. These are the oblique arytenoidus muscle. Okay. Now, the only unpaired muscle of the larynx is transverse arytenoidus, which extends from the posterior surface of one arytenoid cartilage to the posterior surface of another arytenoid cartilage. Which is the origin, which is the insertion, we don't know. This is the only unpaired muscle of the larynx, and that is transverse arytenoidus. Okay. Now, if you see the from the apex, there is one more muscle extending. Now, this is epiglottis. This is the epiglottis, lateral border of epiglottis. From the apex of one sided arytenoid cartilage to the lateral border of corresponding side of epiglottis, there extends a muscle which is called as aryepiglotticus. Aryepiglotticus, which takes origin from the apex of arytenoid cartilage to the lateral border of epiglottis. Similarly on this side. Okay. This is enclosed in a mucous membrane like this, along with one more muscle at the enclosure of this mucous membrane. This is aryepiglottic fold, which already we you know it. Okay. And the other two cartilages, the corniculate and cuneiform cartilages, are enclosed within this fold. This is corniculate and this one is cuneiform, which are a size of a pin's head. Always keeping this aryepiglottic fold in position so as to prevent the collapse of this fold, thus preventing the entry of food particles into the larynx. So this is about the cricoid cartilage and arytenoid cartilage. If you see here, this thickened upper part of cricovocal membrane is nothing but the vocal ligament. This is vocal ligament. The cricovocal membrane, which is thickened, and that forms the vocal ligament. Similarly, from above there is one more ligament extending from the into the aryepiglottic fold, and that is called as quadrate membrane, and that is called quadrate membrane. The thickened lower part of the quadrate membrane. This is now this one. The thickened lower part of this quadrate membrane is called vestibular ligament. Is called vestibular ligament. Okay. This is epiglottis, and again this is area epiglottic fold. This is now. Finally, to conclude, the apex and the adjoining anterolateral surface of the apex is the called as the vocal process of arytenoid cartilage. Now, what structures are attached to the vocal process means you can say this quadrate membrane and thickened part of the lower part of the quadrate membrane, that is a vestibular ligament, quadrate membrane, vestibular ligament, vocal ligament, and here you have vocalis muscle adjoining it. This is vocalis muscle and even thyroarytenoidus muscle. Thyroarytenoidus muscle. So these five structures are attached to the vocal process of arytenoid cartilage. I repeat, quadrate membrane, here you see quadrate membrane, vestibular ligament, thyroarytenoidus muscle, vocal ligament, and vocalis muscle. This vocalis muscle and this vocal ligament surrounded by the mucous membrane is called vocal cords. What are vocal cords? The mucous membrane surrounding the vocalis muscle and vocal ligament is called vocal cords. What is vocal ligament? It is a thickened upper part of cricovocal membrane. What is cricovocal membrane? It extends from the inner lip of the anterior arch of the cricoid cartilage. Anteriorly, what happens to cricovocal membrane? It gets thickened to form a fibrous band called conus elasticus. Posteriorly, it blends with the fibrous capsule of cricoarytenoid joint. So this is all about the cricoid cartilage and as well as arytenoid cartilage. Thank you.